Thanks, and thanks to the organizers. It's always a pleasure to be here, and I don't miss any occasion for this. So I'm going to talk about links between some resolution or deformations of diagonal invariants and representations of finite reductive groups. The link is at this stage weak. I will just explain that the combinatoric on both sides, some examples where we see that the combinatoric on both sides coincide, but we have no explanation for this fact. But I think it was interesting to speak in front of this audience because by reasoning by analogy, questions about finite reductive groups can lead to, I think, questions that might interest symplectic geometer on the other side. I also must confess that I am not a symplectic geometer, so I ask for some indulgence when I talk about symplectic geometry. Okay, so this is also I must say that this is a long-standing, very long-standing, and still in progress work with Raphael, and the content of this talk has been enriched also thanks to discussions with Gwyn Bellamy, Ruslan Maximo, Peng Shan, and maybe others. Okay, so what is the setup? The setup is very small. I have just two objects. A finite dimensional vector space. A finite subgroup acting on V. And since I have denoted it by W, I am forced to assume that it is generated by reflections. Well, the reflections is a set of elements in W such that the codimension of the fixed point is 1. So I don't assume that reflections are order 2. Okay. I also introduce the hyperplane arrangement. So this is a set of reflecting hyperplanes. And I will also have all along my talk a parameter k, which is a family k omega I, where omega is a W orbit of reflecting hyperplanes, and I is between 1 and e omega minus 1, and e omega is just the cardinality, is just the order of the fixator in W of any hyperplane belonging to this orbit. Okay, so this is a kind of parameters you have when you work with eco-algebras, Scherenic algebras, for instance. Okay, so to this datum, I will consider in this talk three different kinds of objects. The first one is that I will denote by G of Q. This is a finite group, a finite reductive group, the group of rational points over a finite field of a reductive group G, which is a reductive group whose value group is W. So this is in the case where W is rational. So when W is rational, I have an associated finite reductive group, and I'm interested in, and that's mainly my subject, I'm interested in the representation theory of this group. The second kind of object is the deformation of the diagonal invariants. Which is called the generalized Calogero-Moser space. And I will denote it by zk of w. I will define it more precisely a little bit later. And the third type of object are partial resolutions that I will denote by xk of w. I'm not going to talk that much about it, but I mention it. And in this case, I must assume that k omega I has values in z, and that the sequences the sequences here is increasing. You will see later why. So k omega 1 is less than or equal k omega 2, and so on. Okay? Well, so I think it's nice to start with an example that will illustrate what I'm going to talk about in this talk. I'm sorry, I really need the full board. And I'm going to look at the example of the symmetric group. So when W is a symmetric group, the associated finite reductive group can be taken to be GLN. The deformation of V cross V star over W will be the Kaloger-Moser space. We denote it by CMN, which is a set of matrices such as the rank of the commutator plus identity is less than or equal to 1, modulo the action of GLN of C. And the resolution I'm going to consider is of course the Hilbert scheme HN. Okay. So I will compare the combinatorics of all these things. The first thing I'm interested in, the set of unipotent characters of G of Q. So unipotent characters are the ones have been defined by Lustig, and in some sense they are the heart of the theory of representation of finite reductive groups. And in this case, it's well known that they are in bijection with irreducible characters of the symmetric group, which in turn are in bijection with the partitions of N. So I will denote the map like this. So rho lambda is a unipotent character associated to the partition lambda. And you see that it's also a well-known fact that the C star fixed point on the Kaloger-Moser space, the C star action is given by multiplication by xi on x and by xi minus 1 on y, is also in bijection with the partitions of n. And I denote by z lambda the corresponding point. And again, it's also a well-known fact that if you take the fixed point under the C star action on the Hilbert scheme, you get something which is in bijection with partitions of n. Of course, for the moment, it's not so spectacular. If you want to find in geometric representation theory something which is in bijection with partition of n, you have okay, lots of examples. But I think that this example must be continued. So, for instance, we can consider the degree of rho lambda. And the degree of rho lambda, there is a formula that says that, well, that can be expressed in terms of the partition. But I write it in this way. It starts with a term with coefficient 1 and a lambda. Capital A lambda is the degree. Little a lambda is the valuation. And in this, it must be said that for us, when you work with representations of finite reductive groups, these invariants are very important. Okay, so it might look not so interesting, but really it's something which has a lot of meaning for us. And in this, in the setup of Kaloger-Moser space, I cannot retrieve exactly the invariants little a and capital A, but I can retrieve the invariant a lambda plus capital A lambda. And this is the evaluation of a natural function that I call the Euler function at z lambda. And I put brackets because there is some normalization. Okay, but you can retrieve this invariant from this. And the Euler function is the one that sets xy
to the trace of xy plus yx.
Okay. So there is a natural function on the Kalojo-Moser space from which you can recover at least the sum of these invariants. But there is a the situation is somewhat better in the Hilbert scheme, because the Hilbert scheme is endowed with a natural ample shift that I denote by O of 1. And I should write, I lambda. So this is an ideal of codimension n in C of xy. And O of 1 is a line bundle, but which is also C star equivariant. I can consider its fiber at I lambda. So this is just a line. And on the Hilbert scheme of C2, you have not only an action of C star, but you have also an action of C star cross C star. So this is just a C, okay, is endowed with an action of C star cross C star. So you can associate two weights coming from the action of C star cross C star. And again, you retrieve the invariants little a lambda and capital A lambda. Again, I put brackets. There is some normalization. So in this case, I can retrieve the invariants I'm interested in from the geometry of this object. Okay, let's go a little bit further. Again, in the representation theory of finite reductive groups, we can compute some decomposition matrices. There is a theory of cells. And in the case of GLN, something which plays an important role in the theory is the dominance order between partitions. For instance, most of the decomposition matrices are triangular with respect to this dominance order. And it's a fact that I don't know how to retrieve it in the Kalojo-Moser space, okay? But we can retrieve the dominance order in the geometry of the Hilbert scheme as follows. So this thing is equivalent to say that if I take, let me write hn hat of I lambda. So I lambda is a fixed point. I consider the attractive set of I lambda for the C star action. This is a subvariety of the Hilbert scheme. I consider the closure of this. And I'm interested in the question whenever this closure meets the attractive set associated to I mu. Okay? And when it is non-empty, and it is non-empty exactly when lambda and mu are in the dominance order, maybe written in this way, that's the other direction, okay? But that's not such a big problem. Okay, so again, something which is important in the representation theory of a finite reductive group can be read from the geometry of the Hilbert scheme. I'm going to talk about some deeper connections, namely by talking about modular representations. So I fix a prime number L which does not divide Q. Oh, I must say that yesterday we had the quantum day, all the day, so Q was a quantum parameter. Here's Q is really a power of a prime number, but in many aspects it behaves as a quantum parameter. So I consider L prime which does not divide Q, and I denote by D the order of Q modulo L. Okay. And it's a well-known fact that what? You can see, I'm sorry, I really need the full blackboard. Okay. Well, so rho lambda and rho mu are in the same L block. If and only if they have the same decor.
So the decor of lambda is equal to the decor of mu.
Okay, so there is a partition of unipotent characters in two blocks, and this is described by this simple combinatorial rule. I don't want to define the decor of lambda. This is a classical classical thing, and I mean it will. It's really not interesting for the rest of the talk. Just given by an easy combinatorial rule, and it's also a fact that that having the same core, having the same decor, is something that can be read in the Calogero-Moser space. It says that z lambda and z mu, so the two fixed points corresponding to the two partitions, are in the same irreducible component of the mu d fixed point on the Calogero-Moser space. So we have an action of c star. I can restrict to an action of mu d, take the fixed point. This splits into irreducible components, and then I can describe whenever I can ask whether z lambda and z mu belong to the same irreducible component, and it turns out that this gives you exactly the same combinatoric as the one coming from L blocks of finite reductive groups. Okay, and in fact, we have the same statement with the Hilbert scheme. So A lambda, blah, 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 mu, blah, 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 the same irreducible component of the mu d fixed point in the Hilbert scheme. Okay, so that's, I think, a little bit more spectacular to retrieve this, something which comes really from modular representation of finite reductive groups in transverse characteristic in the geometry of the Hilbert scheme. I don't want to write here, okay? That's not, so I'm going to raise, stop here. Okay, I want to go on this example by going further in this in the theory of modular representations. So I fix a decor, so gamma a decor, and I denote by b gamma. This is a set of rho lambda such that the decor of lambda is equal to gamma, and I put and I write R to be n minus the size of gamma over d. Okay, so this is a natural number. And there is again a combinatorial process that is called the d quotient, and that tells you that that the set of partitions which have a fixed decor are in bijection with the irreducible characters of GD1R, which is one of the complex reflection group in the infinite family. And this bijection is not explained for the moment, but there is a conjecture by Brouet, Malleux, and Michel, that says the following. So there exists a Deligne-Lustig variety that I denote by x gamma, and the local system f gamma on it, such that what? In the cohomology of this variety, you retrieve exactly the guys which are in this block. So rho lambda
belongs to the block, if and only if it occurs in the cohomology of this delinguistic variety with respect to this local system.
Okay, so that's a first fact. And moreover, the endomorphism algebra of this cohomology
by the endomorphism algebra, I mean the endomorphism algebra of the direct sum of all the HIs.
This must be isomorphic, this should be isomorphic to the Ecke algebra for this group, which is the one here, GD1R, for some parameter that I will denote by K gamma. It depends really on gamma. Okay, so this is a parameter. This is for the group GD1R, a family like this one. Okay, and to this I can associate an Ecke algebra.
So this is a conjecture, and it's far from being proved, but at least it gives some explanation.
And it must be said that the conjecture, as I have said, there exists, but X gamma is given by the conjecture, is provided by the conjecture, F gamma is given, and something important, the parameter is also provided by the conjecture. They give an explicit formula. Okay.
Well, but what happens on the Kalogeromoser side? Well, there is a result by Ruslan, Maximow and me. That says that,
okay, so here I am interested in the irreducible components of the μd fixed point of CMn of D. And in fact, CMn over μd. And I can write it as a union so of irreducible components, which are parameterized by D-core. And the component which corresponds to gamma is exactly a Kalogeromoser space for the group GD1R. So the R, well, let's say write R gamma. And there is some parameter for a Kalogeromoser space. And the parameter here really coincides with the parameter that is involved in this endomorphism algebra. So I think that's something which it's quite intriguing. You can retrieve the parameter of the Ecke algebra, which is defined in terms of an endomorphism algebra of a delinguistic variety inside the geometry of the Kalogeromoser space. Okay, so that's maybe a little bit more surprising. Okay, and here again, there is a result by Eyman. So I write Eyman and Gordon. It's written in a paper by Jan, but Jan told me that all the ideas come from Eyman, which says that if you take the μd fixed point in the Hilbert scheme, again you can write it as a unions over gamma and something which is a symplectic resolution of CR cross CR star over GD1R, R gamma. Okay. So taking the μd fixed point in the deformation, you retrieve deformations of other Kalogeromoser space. And if you take the μd fixed point in this symplectic resolution, each irreducible component is still a symplectic resolution of someone. And again, the combinatorics fits with in all the three situations. Okay, so that's the, maybe this example was the starting point of my, what I'm going to talk about.
Okay.
Okay. Let's talk about this later. Okay. Well, maybe it should be, okay, let's write xk gamma. Okay, so the result of Eyman says this, and a question is that, is this guy isomorphic to the xk gamma of GD1R that I haven't defined, but I will define with this parameter, the same parameter.
Thanks.
Okay. Well, so now let's go back to the general situation. And You see that in this example, which I mean, to my point, is quite nice and intriguing. The symplectic geometry does not play any role, and the reason is that the GLN is really the simplest case. There is no cuspidal representation. The deformation is smooth. There is a symplectic resolution, so everything works really perfectly. But in the other cases, there are some features that really led us to consider the symplectic structure or the Poisson structure on all these varieties. So let's go back to the general case. So let's talk about first unipotent characters. In the type B case, I'm going to explain the deformation you must consider is not the one which is smooth. Okay, to have the right combinatoric. Okay, that's a good question. Okay. So I can still consider the unipotent characters of my group G of Q, my finite group. And inside, and it turns out from the work of Lustig that the unipotent characters of G of Q are in fact, and you have seen it already in the example of GLN, it's of course erased, but the parameter set of the unipotent representation does not depend on Q. And I can really write it as unipotent of W, which means that there is a finite set, a combinatorial finite set, which is associated to W and which is in bijection with the unipotent characters of G of Q. Okay, Q does not play any role in this situation. And in this, inside this finite set which parametrizes the unipotent characters, there is the irreducible characters of W which parametrize the principal series. Okay, and there is some feature that we don't see in GLN, is that the unipotent characters admit a partition into families which are indexed by two-sided cells of W. Families which are called Lustig families, and which are such that if you consider F gamma intersected with the principal series, the irreducible characters of W, then you retrieve the Kajdan-Lustig families, which are defined in terms of the Kajdan-Lustig basis. Okay, so we have a partition into families. We have also a partition into blocks, L blocks. I will come back to this. And there is a partition into Harishchandra series. And the partition into Harishchandra series, in the case of into families for GLN, families are just singletons. Harishchandra series, there is only one Harishchandra series. So that's really why we don't see that much in the case of GLN. But so let's see what we can expect to retrieve. In general. So let me define the Kalojo-Romoser space, the generalized one. So for this, I need to introduce the rational Cherenkov algebras, which is a degeneration of the Daha introduced yesterday by Katarina. So this is the vector space
This is the tensor product of three subalgebras. Where the intertwining between W and the function on V star or on V is the one you imagine. And you have some commutator relation between the element of this subalgebra and this subalgebra. Some commutator relation which involves the parameter k. And I define zk of W to be the spectrum of the center of H0k. When t is different from zero, the center is trivial, so that it has no interest to consider the spectrum. But when t goes to zero, then the center explodes. And for example, if you take k equal to zero, the algebra H0,0 is just the semi-direct product of W with a polynomial function on V cross V star. And in particular, this tells you that Z0 of W is just the invariance for W in this algebra. And so we retrieve the diagonal invariance. And it turns out that when the parameter k varies, this is the flat deformation of this variety. And this is not only a flat deformation, this is a flat Poisson deformation, the Poisson structure coming from the fact that you have a deformation of h through another parameter t.
Cédric, k, yes? K is a family or it's just not a family?
What? K is...
It's the same k.
This is the k which is here, okay? And I think I can now state the first conjecture by Gordon and Martineau. Which says the following thing. So unipotent characters again are defined only if W is a Weyl group. But the Kalogeromoser space is defined for W and for any complex fraction group. So in the case, so if W is a Weyl group, there is a bijection between the two-sided cells or families. So there is a bijection between the two-sided cells and the fixed point in the Kalogeromoser space. But for the parameter 1, I mean, by 1 I mean that all the k's are constant and equal to 1. Okay? So the Kalogeromoser space which should be associated to the theory of unipotent characters is the one for which all the k's are equal to 1. And this bijection should be compatible with the following map. So to each irreducible character, you can associate a two-sided cell. This is the Kashtan-Lustig theory. But there, on the Czernik algebra side, there is a theory of baby Verma module by Jan Gordon that associates to any irreducible character of W any irreducible representation of the algebra H0K. And you can look at the action of the center on this module, and you retrieve a point which is fixed. Okay, so here, if I have z a point here, I denote by cm of z the Kalogeromoser family associated to z. So this is a subset of the irreducible characters of W. Okay, so this conjecture is checked in many cases. So in types A, B, C, D,
So for many people, that would be sufficient, but I really like exceptional examples. So I'm not satisfied with this, okay? Well, you can do G2, but this is easy. It has been proved by Mr. Easy, but for H3, H4, and F4, this has been proved by Mr. Bruton through magma computation with Ulrich Thiel. Okay, so in some sense, this conjecture is quite reliable. Okay. Well.
But this is also for groups, not while group.
The conjecture is for while group. Okay. Okay, because if W is not a while group, I don't have two-sided set. I could have written Coxeter group. Okay, but. Yes, but I should have written Coxeter, okay? Because of the Coxeter group, you have also two-sided cells, okay? Okay, so I think I come to the maybe to the heart of the talk, because. Well, the example of GLN, and together with this conjecture, which is almost proved, shows that, well, you should have a strong relationship between these two sides. And then you can try to figure out what, for instance, if you have a construction on the representation theory side, what would it mean on the geometric side? For instance, in the in the representation theory side, you have the partition into blocks, and this leads. Yes, okay. I'm a little bit confused. Okay. So, what is the analog of blocks? On CM spaces. Well, as we have seen in the GLN example, the analog of blocks is equivalent to taking mu d fixed point. So now I come back to the case where W is complex, K is there is no restriction on K, is any parameter, and there is a would like to state a conjecture by Raphael and me, which says that if you take Z, an irreducible component of the mu d fixed point in the Kaloshor-Moser space, then Z must be isomorphic to the Kaloshor-Moser space, let's say K prime on some W prime for a well-defined W prime per W prime K prime, where W prime is another reflection group. And K prime is another parameter, which has to be understood. What I want to say in this conjecture is that if you start with Kaloshor-Moser space, you take fixed point and you stay in the family of Kaloshor-Moser space. That's what suggests the analogy with partition of blocks in finite reductive groups. And I have some. Almost. W prime, yes. K prime, no. Okay. K prime, no. Okay. And there is a theorem
which is the same theorem I already stated for GLN with Ruslan, is that the conjecture is true if ZK of W is smooth. Okay, so the existence of a parameter for which this Calogero-Moser space is smooth imposes big restriction on W, so W must be of type GD1R, or there is one exceptional group G4. And in the case of GD1R, there is a description of the Calogero-Moser space in terms of Nakajima quiver varieties, and that's the way we were able to prove this conjecture in the smooth case. Okay. And for G4, again, magma was involved. Okay, so that's. So I must also have some other cases. So for instance, I B2, G2, and the group G4, even when the deformation is not smooth. I must say that I have been a little bit optimistic here. Maybe one should take the normalization. Okay, I'm not sure that an irreducible component of the fixed point is normal. In the smooth case, it is smooth, so there is no problem, but maybe we should take, to be careful, we should take the normalization, okay?
I'm sorry, what was it you were saying about B2, G2? G4 is smooth, right? So
there is a deformation which is smooth, but there are deformations which are not smooth and for which the conjecture has a meaning, okay?
So you checked it for all of them.
Oh yes, exactly, that's what I mean. Okay, so that's typically an example of a question on geometry of Calogero-Moser space that is really inspired by the representation theory of finite reductive groups. And I would like to come to something which involves a little bit more the symplectic structure. So, and for this, I need to talk about a little bit about the Harishchandra theory, well, about symplectic leaves, sorry. And the work of Bellamy.
So you're actually saying that this converges for something that's isomorphic to some other complete, but for the whole thing, for some other.
Excuse me, what?
You're actually saying that this is isomorphic to isomorphism of varieties with
the yes.
irreducible component and some other. With the whole thing. Entire Calogero-Moser space.
I didn't
so
catch what.
The right hand side is a full
Calogero-Moser space. It's a. It's really an isomorphism of variety, and it should be also an isomorphism of Poisson variety. Okay.
Ah, okay.
Yes. Okay. Well, so the Calogero-Moser space is a Poisson variety, and it has a stratification. In this case, it has a stratification by symplectic leaves, which is the symplectic leaves are algebraic, and there is a kind of Harishchandra theory of symplectic glyphs done by Gwynne, and it's I start with a definition. So a point in my Calogero-Moser space is called cuspidal. So the if by itself it is a symplectic leaf. So this is a symplectic leaf of dimension 0. And there is a fact proved by Gwynne that this implies that if you have a cuspidal point or a cuspidal symplectic leaf, then the point must be fixed under the action of C star. That's what proved by Gwynne. And there is a theorem by Bellamy that says that there is there exists a natural surjective map from the set of pairs WP-ZP. So WP, this is a parabolic subgroup, and ZP is a cuspidal point of the Kalojromoser space associated to WP, to the set of symplectic glyphs. Of ZK of ZK of W. And this map has the following property, such that if WP ZP is mapped to the symplectic glyph L, and if Z is an element of the symplectic glyph, then you can retrieve the structure of the Cherenkov algebra modulo the ideal defined by Z, thanks to the Cherenkov algebra of WP modulo the corresponding maximal ideal of this cuspidal point. And there is an isomorphic with a matrix algebra of size the cardinality of W over the cardinality of WP of this. Okay. So in some sense, the understanding the representation theory of or the simple modules of H0k of W, if you do it point by point according to the action of the center, then this amounts to understanding the representation theory of this kind of algebra where ZP is a cuspidal point. This is a kind of analog of the Harish-Chandra theory of for finite reductive groups. And another question I would like to explain related to this is the following. So this is a maybe question, conjecture, maybe a little bit optimistic. So take L, a symplectic glyph. Then, do we have an isomorphism between the symplectic glyph or the closure of the symplectic glyph? Again, I take the normalization, but here I know that it is really necessary. Is it isomorphic to a Kalojromoser space of the normalizer of W of WP over WP? So I must precise on which vector space it must act. So I take the fixed point of WP in V, so this is just the vector space on which this group acts naturally, and here there should be some parameter which is explicit. Okay, so again you see that all the constructions we have in finite reductive groups, so taking blocks amounts to taking mu d fixed point, and mu d fixed point you don't go out of the family of Kalojromoser space. If you take a symplectic glyph, then this also should be again a Kalojromoser space for another group. So this is really a kind of geometry where whatever you do, you don't go out of this family of varieties. I have, for this question, I says that's why I don't write a conjecture, I have much less evidence, but there is a work by Bellamy and Till that says that the combinatorics of symplectic glyphs in types B and D BND is very compatible with this conjecture. with this question. And again, some brutal computation, for instance in G4, but in G2 also, shows that this is okay. And for instance, here we really see that we need to take the normalization of the symplectic leaf. The symplectic leaf is not normal, so there is it has no chance to be isomorphic to a Kaluza-Moser space. By taking the normalization, you find that you have really an isomorphism. Okay, so I will not have time to construct xk of w, so okay, my title is a little bit changed. And I would like to conclude with a question raised by Gwyn Bellamy and Raphaël Rouquier. And it has to do with the singularities of this Kaluza-Moser space. So fix the C star fixed point. Okay. So to this C star fixed point, there is a Kaluza-Moser family. So this is a subset of the set of irreducible characters of W, and it's really a question to ask whether we can retrieve information about this set just from the geometry of Z, or in some sense to just thanks to the symplectic singularity at Z. The Kaluza-Moser space has only symplectic singularity, and the question by Bellamy and Rouquier is the following. Take so let's say possibly non-commutative Crepant resolution of the singularity, so zk of w z. I should give a name to this, but sometimes it's a variety, sometimes it's an algebra. Let's say x, okay. Do we have the equality between, well, the rank of the k0 of x, is it equal to the number of irreducible characters I have in my family? So I can retrieve the number of simple modules in the family through the rank of this Crepant resolution. Is it what you meant, Raphaël? You don't remember? Okay, thanks. Thanks for your solidarity. What? Excuse me?
How this resolution depends on this fixed point, small z.
Oh, I'm just taking the resolution, local resolution, okay? Just a local resolution. I'm going to explain two examples. The first one is to take w equals b2 and to take k equal to 1. If the family k is equal to 1. In this case, there is only one interesting point which is not smooth. There is only one non-smooth point in the Kaluza-Moser space. So zk of w singular. Okay, there is only one point like this, and
because it's alone, this guy is a cuspidal point. So I can consider the maximal ideal and its cotangent space. The cotangent space at Z, it has quite a big dimension. In this case, the dimension is 8. Even so, the variety has dimension 4. And because it is a symplectic leaf, it means that the MZ is a Poisson ideal, and this means that the cotangent space at Z is a Lie algebra. And it turns out that in this case, the Lie algebra is isomorphic to SL3 by just, again, brutal computation. And you can, in fact, it's also a fact in this case that you can embed the variety inside the dual, but well, the dual is isomorphic to it through the trace map. So let me write something which is not very, very true, but okay. So we can embed ZKFW inside. Let's write it like this. Okay, this becomes true. So we can write it like this, and if you compute the projective tangent cone of this variety at the point Z, Z is sent to zero. You retrieve exactly the minimal nilpotent orbit of SL3. And there is a result by Beauville in his paper on symplectic singularities that says that if you have an isolated symplectic singularity such that the projective tangent cone is smooth, then it must be a singularity which is isomorphic to a minimal orbit of something. And of course, in this case, this tells you that ZK of W Z as a symplectic singularity, this is equivalent to the minimal orbit of SL3, the closure of this at zero. Okay? And it's well known that this minimal orbit has a crepant resolution through the cotangent bundle to P2, and if you take the fiber above zero, you get a fiber which is isomorphic to P2, and the K0 of P2 has rank 3, which is exactly the number of irreducible characters in this family. Okay, so that's a small example through which we can check this question. The last one, I have 2 minutes. Is to take W equal G2 and K generic. Again, there exists a unique singular point. In this case, the corresponding Lie algebra structure on the cotangent bundle is isomorphic to SP4. Again, by the theorem of Beauville, the symplectic singularity is isomorphic to the minimal nilpotent orbit of SP4 at zero. But the minimal nilpotent orbit of the closure of the minimal nilpotent orbit has no crepant resolution. It has no commutative crepant resolution. But as a singularity, maybe as a variety, but as a singularity, this is equivalent to C4, the quotient of C4 by mu2 acting diagonally at zero. Okay, this is an isolated singularity. And the quotient of C4 by mu2 at zero, it has no crepant, no algebraic variety, which is a crepant resolution, but it has a non-commutative crepant resolution. So crepant resolution is mu2 semi-direct C of x, y, x prime, y prime. And again, the K0 of this guy has rank 2, which is exactly the number of irreducible characters in the Kalogeron-Moser family in this case. Okay, so this is... It's 10, exactly 10. So, Michaela, I think I can stop here. Yes.